Good morning. Welcome. My name is Korey. I'm a tango dancer and a composer and a bandoneon player and a band leader. I like tango a lot, both the music and the dance, and I want to share something with you today about a topic that was actually suggested. This was a wish topic from Felipe and Ayano, which is essentially this idea that, tango orchestras are not all the same, and maybe not all of the same value for us as dancers or as DJs. We got a big controversy started here already. And then the question underneath that, what makes this big four orchestra important for dancers, or you could say essential for dancers, yeah? How we would hope not to have a milonga without hearing a little bit of all of these four orchestras, I think is the sort of underlying vibe of this presentation. Maybe a good thing for me to start with is, does it work for you? Okay, good, good. I'll do the talk show host here. Great. Like a man. Okay, so I wanted to introduce these big four band leaders to you. Let's see, where are they? Come on, guys. Ah, here we go. Yes, and you know, there's this presumption that we all are familiar with these names and faces, but maybe it's not true. Who's this first guy on the left here? Darienzo. Thank you, Felipe. Yes, that is one Darienzo. Somebody other than Felipe. Who's number two? DeSarli. Yes. There's our DeSarli. And number three? Very good. And who's our last one? Troilo. Okay. These are the big four, yeah? And if we were giving this presentation in sort of a land that valued soccer, yeah, we could call this our Tango All-Star team, and it would be a very cute presentation to go for it. But we're in the U.S., yeah, and I actually cherish the differences in culture. So I'm going to introduce them to you this way. This is like the MCU version of the Big Four. Yeah, this was the plane ride over. Yeah, that was Frankfurt to Chicago right there. In between my son waking up from his naps. Okay, so you know everything you need to know about these guys, right? We'll do it in another way too. But I want to look at the question, what would make these essential orchestras for tango dancers? Yeah, what is behind that claim? And this is not my claim, yeah, and this is not Felipe's claim or Ayano's claim. This is a claim that has been around as long as people have been talking about tango music for dancers. So I think the first thing we should acknowledge is that this is kind of the traditional perspective of the tango world. And we'll see what that's based on, yeah? But I say that as a starting point because we can't change it. Yeah, so there's no point in arguing about this. This is something we've inherited. Yeah, we can like it or we can not like it, but it's there. Yeah, these are the four orchestras that our tango ancestors have deemed are essential. Yeah, live with it. Good. But I think there's something else behind this, because when this music is in our culture and we dance a lot to this music and we have really nice dances to this music, this changes our experience of the music. Yeah, we have this sort of kind of well of good vibes that go along with certain songs that we've heard a lot and had nice dances to. And that changes our experience of the music. And I think this is a funny psychology of tango music for dancers. A part of the experience of the music is not just what you're hearing now. It's your memory of your dance experience of that music in the past, or so I believe. Yeah. So these orchestras that have been prominent in tango for generations have a higher degree of sort of presence in our pool of tango memories. Yeah, so I think from this perspective also, they're going to be with us. Well, one of the reasons for that is math, yeah? Each of these four orchestras produced a tremendous amount of material, and because the world around them was saying, these are the big ones, these are popular, their material was often re-released and repackaged and resold. So we have, I don't see my little notes here that I'm gonna estimate. D'Arienzo, these are just the number of tangos, yeah? Not waltzes or milongas, just the number of tangos, individual tracks that have been released under the name of D'Arienzo or his orchestra, about 4,500. No, they're not unique songs. They're unique, they're not even unique recordings. They're unique commercial products, yeah? I would say many of these songs were released four or five times in different compilations or packages, yeah? But still, the number of tracks commercially available from D'Arienzo, over 4,000. From Troilo, we've got, let's call that 3,800. Pugliesi is just under 3,000. De Sarli's hanging out there around 2,000. And to compare them with some other favorite orchestras, yeah, just that we see, okay, that's a substantial difference with Tanturi. Calos is looking for his place there, but not really in the same level mathematically. Here's where the idea breaks down. Yeah, there's at least one orchestra that we don't call part of the Big Four, and he outsells them all. Yeah, this is sort of the businessman's orchestra. Canaro was very effective at marketing himself and his orchestra. Over 6,000 tangos commercially available, or recordings of tango commercially available. Good. So quantity is one of the factors which makes these part of the Big Four. I think longevity is another one that we should look at. These orchestras all had a big lifespan. They were playing together, and they were playing in the dance hall for quite a while. De Sarli there is getting close to 30 years. Troilo even longer. D'Arienzo goes into the mid-70s. Pugliesi's orchestra keeps playing until 95, yeah? And there are players in this orchestra that have played together for over 30 years. So there's something unique about the sound and the style and the product that evolves after 30 years of collaborating together. And for comparison, yeah? So from longevity also, I think we can say, okay, these guys are in a different category. They've played together a long time, and that makes a little difference. I think one of the things that gets more interesting for me for our talk today is what these orchestras have contributed to tango music and hopefully to the tradition of tango music for dancers. And I think with each of these, we have something particular. D'Arienzo is best known for a sort of rhythmic dominance, yeah? El Rey de Compás, he's the orchestra that makes us move our feet, yeah? De Sarli is kind of a champion of melody, of elegance, of texture. And this is something that comes not originally from him into tango music, but definitely through him as a stronger influence in tango music. Mr. Troilo. What to say about Troilo? We'll say a lot about Troilo, yeah. But in terms of musical contributions, I see Troilo as sort of a tool for bringing very complex ideas to our feet, yeah? There are orchestras before Troilo, most notably De Caro, that had very sophisticated tango arrangements and very sophisticated ways of approaching the music that were not very successful or popular with dancers, yeah? Troilo continues that tradition, but brings it with a rhythmic drive and with a sort of baseline of emotional impact that maybe dancers didn't find in De Caro, and kind of mainstreams this idea of a progressive or evolutionary tango. And then Pugliesi. Pugliesi's in his own category, both musically and dance-wise. Pugliesi changes the genre of tango, and he does it while he's still playing for tango dancers. This is something we'll look at a little bit later. All of these orchestras change over time. Tango music changes over time. Some of these people are pushing that envelope, and some of these people are following or being pulled by that change. Good. now the part that's interesting for us, I hope. And this is the part that isn't really documented, as far as I'm aware, yet. Yeah, there were lots of nice facts and descriptions and historical analysis of these orchestras that maybe you read before we started. But as far as I know, there isn't much discussion about what each of these orchestras do for us as dancers. And so in order to talk about this, I want to give you guys a little bit of background, nomenclature, some basics in how I like to look at tango music as a dancer. Yeah, I'm going to oversimplify because we only have a short time, but I would say there are three main things that we get attached to as tango dancers in tango music. And the musicians talk about these in terms of musical words, marcato, which is the rhythmic bass that drives the music, usually played with short notes, or staccato, sounds a little bit like this. Yes, of course. Yeah. Legato. This is kind of the opposite of staccato. It means smooth, connected, creamy. Yeah. And this is, I think, best typified by. Yeah, there's a totally different world there for us as dancers, yes? Well, the next is, I would say essential. It's not as prominent as the first two. It's not half of our tango universe. It's maybe a tenth of our tango universe. But syncopation. Good. What is syncopation? Wow, that's great. This is, yeah. We have in tango this strong beat. Can we make this beat together? Yeah. Everything that doesn't match this beat. Ba, 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 da, ba. Da, 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 da. That's syncopation, yeah? And this is something that exists in every tango orchestra to a degree. Troilo, who is the author of the example that we just listened to, this is sort of a key part of his style, I would say. So we have these colors here, nice, vibrant keynote colors. And these are things that I'm using as a shortcut to show what the music has for us as dancers. And I'll animate those for you with some examples that we can see a little bit what this music might contain for us to dance to. Well, then this is actually something I'm making up here. This is something I wish for. Yeah, wouldn't it be nice if we have a profile for a tango orchestra? If we could know in three or four quick little things, what's the character, what's the sort of style, the basic ingredients of this tango orchestra? I suppose this is very American to want to boil it down to something so compact. But I would imagine this profile is made up of, one, how the orchestra uses rhythm. And there are a few kind of basic building blocks of tango rhythm. Which ones does the orchestra choose? Yeah. The proportion of these two worlds, of legato and staccato, of melody and rhythmic drive, how that shapes the orchestra's approach to tango music, I think for us as dancers is significant, is important. Maybe it affects our choice of movements or our speed or our quality of motion. The way that the orchestra employs syncopation. Is it something quietly in the background? Is it kind of essential to the piece? Does it come out of the melody? Does it come as a surprise against the melody? All of these things make a difference for us, I think, as dancers. Well, this one is a little bit fine, but I'm going to argue it affects us at least on a psychological level. What is the form of the tango that we're dancing to? How many people are familiar with the idea that tango may have sections, and these sections recombine into a form or a shape? Yeah, sort of like these little building blocks here, A and B and A and B. Some orchestras do this in a very sort of traditional and straightforward way, and other orchestras do this in a very dynamic way. They invent their own form, or they change or modify the form, or stretch it in places to kind of fit their creative impulse. So for us as dancers, sometimes this means excitement, and sometimes this means confusion. Yeah, but how the orchestra deals with the arrangement and the form of the music, I think, has an effect on us, at least in our comfort zone. Yeah. And finally, this is totally subjective, but the character, the kind of emotional value or the raw feeling of the music, I think, would be part of our profile. So here we go, D'Arienzo's profile. First, it would be nice to know he was known in his time as el rey del compás, the king of the beat, or the groove master, I would say. And his basic ingredients, yeah, the rhythm is based on something called marcato in four. Can we go? We hear to some degree every beat in this music, yeah? It's persistent. It drives us forwards. We hear it about 60% of the time as the main ingredient, yeah? There are other layers. Here comes something legato, yeah? But more than half the time, we've got this driving beat and short notes on top. The form in D'Arienzo is almost always completely traditional, yeah? It's exactly the way that the piece was written. Yeah, and this, I think, for us as dancers is very comfortable. Yeah, there are no surprises, almost no surprises. They come later, yeah? And as for character, I would characterize D'Arienzo as assertive. Yeah, this is not a sort of laid-back or relaxed orchestra. This is a in-your-face orchestra, yeah? And I think this was very intentional. D'Arienzo, when quoted, said, well, the important thing for a tango orchestra is basically energy, yeah? Subtlety is not a part of it. Drive, energy, get these people moving. So this is his sort of artistic world or his profile. Yeah? And I'm going to animate a D'Arienzo recording to kind of show this. I chose a song that's recorded by all four orchestras, and we'll see it from each of them. I think you know this song. Okay, what was that all about? Does anybody know this term, la vaca? Yeah, what is la vaca? The cow, naturally, yeah? And yes, it's a solo played on the low string of the violin with a lot of vibrato. It actually takes some muscle to do this. It's a bit athletic. It's a characteristic device. It's not every song that features this, but let's say 85%. This is D'Arienzo's go-to trick. Yeah, he's a rhythmic orchestra, and this is his way of kind of compensating for it. He brings the cow, yeah, to make us linger a little bit. Okay, let's look at Mr. Pugliese. So as a profile, first I should tell you, yeah, his nickname, San Pugliese, and I don't know the story. Does anybody know the story? Why is he Saint Pugliese? Okay, it will remain a mystery, but apparently he is. Yeah, he was a really nice guy. Yeah, everybody liked him. His music employs a mix of rhythmic impulses. Yeah, we can't say it's all in two, although it's often in two. We can't say it's all in four, but he uses four. We can't say it's all syncopated, but that's there too. Yeah, it's all the resources are on the table. A little bit more legato than staccato. And this idea of an episodic form, not a form that goes A, B, A, B, but a form that goes A, and then B, and then C, and then something like A, but different, yeah? It's music that's possible to kind of get lost in, or immersed in, and it's music that's very dynamic, yeah? Whereas most tango music for dancers is quite repetitive. We hear something once, and we're really sure we're gonna do the same thing at least one more time, maybe two more times. We lose that with Pugliese. He's moving forward. He's moving to the next thing. Yeah. So his profile looks like this, and his El Choclo. Let's dance, Osvaldo. Please. Looks like this. So I guess we could say the constant is change. Yeah, the thing that makes this predictable is that it's not predictable. Yeah, and we, yeah, it is very dramatic. It's driven by effect. It's driven by a sort of lyrical sense of the music that could change in any moment. Very exciting, not very simple. Well, here's our next character, El Señor del Tango, Carlos de Sarli. As the name suggests, a little bit elegant or cultivated. And I would describe his style as being based on a marcato in two. Can we find this marcato in two? Just to feel it, what happens if we go on four? Feels like we're not with the music anymore, right? And back to two. Now his rhythmic bass, his heartbeat is in two. Dominated by lyrical or melodic. This is the kind of breakdown of this section. And you can see, okay, we have some rhythm there, but it's not the first priority, yeah? The form is traditional, but not always, especially in the vocal tangos, not always in these nice, even eight count building blocks, yeah? So careful if you're giving a class on phrasing and you want to count to eight, watch out for the de Sarli vocals, yeah? They'll trip you up. Good. And the overall character, I would say, reserved and elegant.
So, for contrast, let's listen to the same song, El Pulito, recorded by the orchestra of Juan Tarienzo.
So, same song, two different worlds, yes? One in four, one in two, one very kind of thoughtful and expansive, the other one, boom, 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 boom. And this starts our contrast. El Choclo should look like this. Well, for a lyrical orchestra, there's a lot of rhythm there, yes? And it's not the most typical example of his, but I think it's actually really helpful, or let me say it's intentional, yeah? For me, it's important that we don't completely stereotype these orchestras. I'm giving you a profile, but it's good to know that all of these orchestras use all of the resources, yeah? It's just a question of proportions and maybe priorities. But here, in this first section of El Choclo, we have a lot of rhythm, yeah? In the second section, he balances it out. Yeah, we end up about with the same proportions. Well, here comes Mr. Troilo and his nickname, Pichuco, which means crybaby. Yeah, it's a reference to the special sound that he was able to evoke from his instrument, and we hear this a lot in his arrangements, solo bandoneon, in a sort of weepy, very emotional way of playing. A master of tone and dynamic, not a technical master of the instrument. And it's interesting, a lot of bandoneon players regard him as the greatest, yeah? But he's certainly not the fastest, and he certainly doesn't play the most complicated things. It's a question of emotional content in his playing that's attractive to other musicians, which I'm, for one, very happy for. So. Here comes some Troilo, marcato in four. We have very traditional form, but innovative arrangements, which is to say the song stays as we expected it, but in the case of this song, the melody is missing for the first 16 bars, yeah? That's unusual. That's a little bit odd, yeah? And then the melody comes in a piano solo shortly after. The overall feeling, complex. There's a lot going on, yeah? And then, of course, this characteristic syncopation. So So if you look at the screen, that's a mix. Yeah, we've got a lot of different colors and flavors to work with there as dancers. And I think one of the things that makes this orchestra successful is that he balances this variety with a pretty clear pulse. Yeah, we're not going to lose time with Troilo. We're not going to get lost in the arrangement with Troilo. He's going to keep us going in the way we expect, but with a pretty rich tapestry, a pretty rich selection of things that we might dance or interpret. So, El Choclo from Troilo, it's not his best, yeah, but it looks like this. And again, a variety of colors. Yeah, we have different flavors to choose from as dancers. We have some syncopation. We have a lot of melody or sort of lyrical texture. A little bit of solid rhythm to play with as well. Good. Are there questions before I move past this sort of overview phase? Yes. Ah, good. In a fairly scientific way, it turns out. This is all subjective, yes, but it's not pulled out of the air. I took some examples that I thought were sort of appropriate music, and I tallied up the number of bars that were predominantly rhythmic or predominantly lyrical or syncopated, and put those numbers in a chart, and this is what the chart program came up with. Yeah? So, yeah, there it is. For today, no. For today, I'm looking at the musical tool that each instrument is using. And then for me, a little bit for me as a dancer too, I would say a bandoneon melody that is legato is not so different for me as a dancer than a violin melody that is legato. But a bandoneon melody that's staccato, that's short notes with energetic accents, that's very different. And the same thing with violin. I would say which instrument is playing it is for me less influential than what it is that is being played. So I'm focusing more on what the musical content is, not which instrument is playing that content. But it is something that differentiates these orchestras. Yeah, there are different roles in different orchestras and different instruments that sort of dominate. Yeah. How do I define the 12% here? This is our syncopation color. So this is the thing that puts emphasis or important sort of strength away from our strong beat, which for me as a dancer means we might want to move differently. Yeah, if the music is no longer going like this, but going ta ta ba ta ba ta ba ba, then I think, okay, maybe I'm doing something different than quick, quick, slow, quick, quick, slow, in order to catch the feeling of that. Yeah, so that's what the orange reflects. And in terms of this graphic, that's for me when that's the prominent thing. Yeah, in every tango orchestra, there is syncopation somewhere in the texture in every song. Yeah, it's just a question of whether it dominates in that moment. And that's subjective. Yes. Yes. Not very statistically significant, yeah? If you would like to listen to a couple hundred songs, I can give you the table to put it into, and we can make it more statistically significant. I chose songs that were sort of favorites for me that I thought were characteristic of these orchestras in the dance period. Yeah, these are songs that I would play as a DJ, because there's a lot of music from these orchestras that I wouldn't play as a DJ. So I took songs that I liked, and I went through this process. But honestly, maybe four songs, yeah? Each song takes, let's say, 15, 20 minutes to kind of get through and be accurate. So, yeah, I'm for today, it's not statistically significant, but I think it's nonetheless valid, yeah? I think this represents a tendency of these orchestras, and what I can say is the numbers were very similar from one song to the next, yeah? It wasn't such a widespread. So I think we could do this with one song and come up with almost the same pie chart, yeah?
I don't want to put you on the spot, but you
We will. It's coming up. It's coming up. Yes. I hope we have time to get there, because there's a moment when we'll look at like special effects from each orchestra, and that's something we can hear from Troilo. Good. Okay. I'm going to move on then. So I want to move into a next section here, which is a little bit how these orchestras might interact with each other or influence each other. And what happens over this long lifespan with the orchestras. And we'll see. I may kind of speed up through here. But I want to share one piece of this with Pugliese that I think is interesting for us as dancers. Yeah, this is a little bit where my very simple binary world of tango for dancers breaks down. Yeah, with Pugliese, I think it's difficult to say it's just rhythmic or it's just lyrical, because there's so much in between. So I came up with a little list of ways to differentiate this spectrum. The first one, something very crisp. One idea, repeated over and over again, very short, very crisp, and that for me is a potato chip, yeah? The second, in this composition is sort of an answer for that. It's to take the idea and kind of turn it on its head. What's interesting and what's unique for this orchestra is that everybody is playing this syncopation. Yeah, this is what the word tutti means, that all the instruments are playing together. And that's special. That's something that didn't really happen before this orchestra. Yeah. Good. Legato. We know legato, yeah? And in terms of our spectrum, I'm going to give legato a nice bowl of yogurt. Yeah, this is the case when everybody is playing long notes. And in this orchestra, playing long notes means we change, we evolve, we don't hold the sound, but we get louder, we get softer, we use vibrato, we phrase. Everything which makes it sort of lively, lebendig is the word that jumps into my head if anybody speaks German. This is the resource that's at play when we have this world of yogurt, yeah? Good. Now, here's something special with Pugliese. He very often gives us this creamy texture with all the tools that go with it, but there's still a strong beat there. And so I'm thinking, okay, this is a little bit like yogurt with granola. Islands on top, super creamy. That we keep this rhythmic drive going even when there's the sort of luxuriating legato sound. Here's again something that it's not in the end unique to Pugliese, but I think it starts with Pugliese. The idea, again, that everybody is playing something together, but that something is a little bit out of time, yeah, is no longer metric, yeah? By metric, I mean no longer divides evenly the beat. I call these tutti gestures with rubato. It means everybody's playing together, and they're playing with some rhythmic freedom. It's quite difficult to do with a whole group of people, and it sounds like this. And again, the reason for me to go into this level of detail is that as a dancer, it doesn't feel the same. I'm not satisfied to just call that legato. Yeah, I'm not satisfied to think, okay, here's the Sarli melody, and I can do something like a lapis or do a calicita around my partner. It feels like there's something different here, because everybody is doing this together, and they're stretching time when they do it. So then I need a different icon. I need a different way to show that's a special moment. It's not just legato. It's a tutti gesture, rubato. Okay. Then we go even further, yeah? We have moments that are clearly legato in our spectrum of things, but they're like super legato, yeah? And I think in Pugliese, this is often expressed with a single instrument, that he gives the voice to a violin or to a bandoneon. And then I think, okay. Yeah, it has to be dulce de leche, yeah? It's just like creamier than creamy, yeah? Very rich, very sweet. Good. And then the last one, yeah? This is a case where we have legato, we have our sort of long notes, our lyrical sound, but there's this push and this drive of accented, sort of syncopated music that we associate with Troilo or D'Arienzo at the same time. And that sounds like this. Almost like he can't make up his mind. Yeah, we're going to be sort of dreamy. No, we're going to be really hard and aggressive. No, let's do them both. Yeah, and I think this again for us as dancers is something special. I think I wouldn't be satisfied to just sit there with two choices. Is it smooth or is it crunchy? Yeah, I want a different texture for that. So we end up then in this music that comes from Pugliese, and I would say after Pugliese, with a bigger spectrum. Yeah, with possibilities that are purely rhythmic, syncopated rhythmic, legato, but with sort of syncopation or a lack of rhythmic clarity. Our mix of all, yeah, all the textures together, accents and legato, all of it in nice dessert size. Legato with marcato, legato alone, and super legato, yeah? So then we have this whole spectrum from short to long or from crispy to super creamy sweet. And I want to put that in context, comparing two of our orchestras. Yeah, this song, do you know Nueve de Julio? It's probably, no, does anybody have, is this their favorite tango of all time? Nueve de Julio? Come on! No, and yet it's funny because this is like the first tango that every tango band learns to play. Yeah, it's pretty straightforward, it's pretty easy, it's fun to play, but yeah. Yeah, it's Nueve de Julio. But it's also a piece that was recorded often, and we've got two pretty representative versions, actually three. I'm going to play from 1935, the D'Arienzo recording of Nueve de Julio. Super straightforward, right? No complications, a nice bookend shape. It's a marcato sandwich. Yeah. Pugliese records the same piece 10 years later. Well, of course, it's going to be different from Pugliese, yeah? And it comes out a little bit like this. Kind of stretching each texture to his style, yeah. Instead of straightforward, he's giving us the sort of amplified version, and yeah, lots of treats along the way. Well, D'Arienzo's a good businessman, yeah. Not about to be outdone by this little spooky guy here in the corner. He comes back some years later and records his version and has actually incorporated some of the same innovations, some of the same sort of exaggerations of the basic resources. In 1966, this is a different audience. Yeah, this is probably no longer written for the dance hall, but for tango for export. Yeah, to be recorded and sold overseas. But I think it also reflects a sort of development of the style that's been happening in the time since the 1935 recording. Which one would you rather dance to? I mean, if you had to dance Nueve de Julio, yeah, and we had to dance D'Arienzo, would you pick the 35 or the 66? How many for 35? How many for 66? Oh, okay, good. I think this reflects sort of where we are in tango. I would predict If I'd asked this question 10 years ago, we would have one or two hands for the 1966 version. Yeah, we'd say, oh, no. We don't dance anything after 1949. Yeah. And now we're in a world with a lot more plurality, a lot more sort of differences in taste. And it was nearly 50-50 from my eyes, from people who liked the sort of traditional version or people who liked the modern version. There's no right and wrong. Yeah, we have our tastes and we dance what we like. What might be useful to consider is, why was the music written? Yeah, and the music in 1935 was explicitly written to get people on the dance floor. That's the only way this recording could succeed, was to get people on the dance floor. And the one recorded in 1966 had a different goal, a different commercial goal. Yeah, well, we're no longer in 1935 or 1966, and we have a great spectrum to choose from. But this makes the topic a little more complex. Yeah, when we say D'Arienzo, which D'Arienzo are we talking about? Yeah, D'Arienzo in the 60s is a totally different orchestra in a way from D'Arienzo in the 30s. Good. So this brings us to sort of special tricks that these orchestras are known for, and I want to show a couple of those in the context of this song, with at least these two orchestras that we're comparing. Pugliesi has this really nice way of writing solis. A soli is a sort of special featured section of the orchestra. In this case, it's a bandoneon soli, where the whole line of players takes the front of the stage, basically, and has a feature. You hear this in Troilo, but apart from that, you don't hear this very often. Yeah, this is kind of a special Pugliesi thing. And we can go on. D'Arienzo, okay, what's his trick? Anybody know? Okay, I had too much time on the plane, but what I'm hoping is that it brings your attention to the effect. Yeah, we see a cow and we think, oh, there's something different in the music. Yeah, and maybe when you're dancing later to a D'Arienzo set and the sound comes on, you'll be thinking about floating cows, and I'm sure your dancing will be better for it. Yes, good. So, what about the other two orchestras? What can we say would be a special trademark from Troilo's orchestra, or a thing that he brought into the dance? And here I would say first, this special sound of his bandoneon, the pachuco sound. I think the thing that's interesting and remarkable at this time is the restraint. Yeah, here's all the energy of the song after the singer focused on this moment, and he comes out and plays a little tiny thing up high on the bandoneon with a lot of time, very relaxed. Yeah, and this is a unique characteristic of this orchestra. He says, "Yeah, I'm not going to hit you over the head with it. I'm going to hold it back and savor." From interviews and from people who played with him and talked about him, the important thing for him was the emotional content of the music, which is, for background information, why I chose the Hulk to represent him. Yeah, the Hulk is driven by emotions, yes, and so there's Troilo driven by emotions. It also looked cute with his head on there. Another thing that I think is fascinating, or sort of a hallmark of Troilo, which is quite difficult to talk about or explain, but I'm going to ask some dancers to give us a picture of it, is the relationship. Now we get another bandoneon solo. Oh, this one from Quejas de Bandoneon. So by now, this is kind of a trademark thing for him. The arranger gets the whole orchestra out of the way so we can hear him playing in kind of a soft and very thoughtful way. Yes, Interestingly, there's so much to talk about. This doesn't really fit in the presentation, but I want to tell you guys, because we talk about Troilo as if it was Troilo making all the magic, and we talk about Daddy Enzo as if it was all of his responsibility. In many cases, these guys didn't do the arrangements for the orchestra, yeah? And in the sort of peak period in Buenos Aires, early 40s, there were maybe six guys writing the arrangements for almost every orchestra. And then the work of these guys was to know what's special about this orchestra. How do I do a Troilo arrangement instead of a Tanturi arrangement? Yeah, and I think a little bit how these styles got defined is the arrangers figuring out how to please their clients. Yeah, and the reason that similar devices are used over and over again is not necessarily that the orchestra loved that device, but that the arranger knew he could sell that device to the band leader. Yeah, just something to think about. Behind every sort of superhero, there's a team of people making it happen, yeah? And in this case, there's some sort of unsung heroes that are often not even identified. Some of these pieces, I wasn't able to find who did the arrangement, but in Troilo's case, Troilo was not an arranger, yeah? And most of the things recorded by his orchestra were not arranged by him. The original Quejas de Banonion, that we think this is Troilo's anthem, yes? This was arranged by Piazzolla. Astro Piazzolla, the guy who writes music that we can't dance to, right? He's responsible for this beautiful arrangement. It's really a remarkable arrangement of what considers which is considered to be a dance classic. Yeah, so you never know. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
So is it
That's an interesting question. In a way, yes. There's also a spectrum here. This is not all one flavor. Yeah. Most of these people also created music for their own orchestra. They were the composer. Yeah. So even if they didn't do the arrangement for the whole thing, Troilo, for example, composed a lot of tangos that we say are classics today. Yes. Okay. Great. The composer thinks up the tune. The composer says, hey, I would really like a tango that goes da 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 dee da 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 dee da dee da 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 dum da 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 dee. The arranger says, okay, we've got 12 guys here on stage. What do each of them play for your tune? Yeah? And do they play short notes or do they play long notes? Do they play marcato in two or marcato in four? Or do they give us syncopa? All of these decisions are basically arranging decisions. Yeah? The composer, for this style, I would say, generally creates the melody and a structure. Yeah? And the rest is rearranged, which is why we can hear the same song recorded in so many different versions that sounds so different, because they were different arrangements of the same composition. Yeah, it's a great question. I want to show you a little bit what I would argue is a second kind of trademark or a special feature of Troilo, and this is the subtle one. Yeah, it already starts with a subtle word, fraseo, yeah, which I'm using in this context not to be about the length of a phrase, but to be about the delivery of a rhythmic idea. Yeah, if I talk like this, I'm using zero fraseo. Yeah, everything else has some bending or lilting or compressing or stretching of sound and syllable. This we could call fraseo. Yeah. Well, in Troilo's orchestra, this is a fundamental thing, yeah, especially in working with vocalists and especially in working with Fiorentino. And the relationship of the orchestra to that stretchiness is something that I think is first perfected or captured in this orchestra from Troilo. Yeah, and I want to show you two very short clips of dances to the same song, the same recording, the same song. And in the first clip, I would suggest that the dancers here in the left are... they're dancing the orchestra. They're dancing the rhythmic bass of this section. Yeah, with a little more time, I would record just the orchestra background and take out the vocal, and you could see their movements match it, sort of like Mickey Mouse in a cartoon, yeah? That the soundtrack and the visuals are very tightly synchronized. And then we have this pair on the right. It's either a synchronization problem with the sound on the video, or I think more likely, because the rest of the video is perfectly in sync, that they're ignoring the orchestra. and they're listening to the singer, and they're basing their movements on the arrival of the lyrical ideas from the singer. And this looks like this. A different emotional world, yeah? Instead of pom pom, it's da 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 dee. And this is something I think that's a challenge in this music, but it's also something really special about this music, yeah, that we have more than one way to approach the music, and it's very artfully handled in this orchestra. Again, that was the subtle one, yeah? Desarli, trademarks. So, the big story here is that the whole orchestra is able to play in the way that somebody would sing. Yeah, and that's not easy. Yeah, Desarli in legato is sort of definitively fraseo. Yeah, I want to try to get an experience of that, yeah, an experience that's not based on graphics or special animations. But we're going to do a little sing-along, yeah, and for the sing-along, we need to know the words. They're very easy, yes, and you might relate to these personally. I love to dance to Desarli. Desarli, Desarli. Can we practice that? I love to dance to Desarli. Desarli, Desarli. I love to dance to Desarli. Because it's really cool. Okay, it fits the melody, yeah? But I want to do that once very straight, yeah? So we're just going to do 3, 4. I love to dance to Desarli. Desarli, Desarli. 3, 4, 1. I love to dance to Desarli because it's really cool. But that's not really cool, yeah? That feels kind of dumb, yeah? And we sound so cheesy, yes. Yes, we sound like non-tango musicians trying to play tango. No, really. Really, I don't mean that as a dig. I don't mean that as something negative. But this is one of the most difficult things for musicians coming into tango style to get. Because what we just did is exactly what's on the page for them in the most part. Yeah? Unless they have a very helpful arranger who's tried to write out the sort of rhythmic placement of these things. That's what you get. You pick up a copy of Bahia Blanca, and it has da 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 da. Yeah? But we don't want it to sound like that. Yeah? So now I want to sing along with the orchestra and see if we can grab his sense of how this melody works. You ready? Sing loud. It'll help. Super. Yeah. And then the remarkable thing is the whole line of musicians, 4 violins, sometimes 6, 4 bandoneons, they're all playing this sort of elastic rhythm together. Yeah. And it comes out sounding like that. That's something special in this orchestra. The other thing that I think we can recognize or sort of say as a hallmark of this orchestra and this style, I call these piano champagne bubbles. Yeah. It's little fills or effects in the piano that don't take a lot of space or attention, but give a sort of texture or an atmosphere to the music. And here's an example. Yeah. Maybe another little example. I think this is somehow a little bit of this signore de tango. This is something very fine, very subtle. It's not hitting us over the head, but it makes a special feeling or a special texture in this music. And that's something that I think we owe to Desarli. Yeah, I think that originated with him. Good. I need to make some decisions here. I'm going to forge ahead, but I may skip over. Can we skip Compressita? Do you mind? No, nobody minds. Good. I want to compare these guys with songs that are actually kind of nice to dance to and where they all have reasonable versions of them. And the first of these is Ojos Negros. The one that we hear most often as dancers is this one from Disarli, I think, 1945. Good. It's what we would expect from Disarli, yeah? It's all the kind of basic elements, well done, and no surprises, yeah? And it sounds like this. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's just saying that there are no surprises, that the second time that the melody comes back, it sounds just like it did the first time. I'm not going to play the whole thing, but give you the second A just that you can hear first. About 2 minutes later in the piece, it sounds just like it did the beginning, right? Just so you know, it's really the second time, yeah? That's the end. That's the end of the piece, but it ended just like it started, yeah? And I think this is something characteristic of these orchestras. For the most part, keeping us in this safe zone is a plus, yeah? Until we get to Pugliesi. Well, we'll hear that soon enough. But let's hear Ojos Negros. Oh, I'm missing my superhero here. But from the dates, I'm going to guess this is Troilo. And it sounds like, oh, we're missing some graphics. Yeah, to really kind of establish all these little bullet points on here would take me about 30 minutes, and I don't have the time. But trust me, there's interesting things happening here in this orchestra. We don't hear this version, or I don't hear this version very often. Are the DJs in the room who play this one? Yeah? Ojos Negros from Troilo? At least Felipe does. Go to Felipe's Milongas, yeah? Okay, good. It's a very nice, I would say a very sophisticated treatment of this song, and totally danceable. Good. I think I can. Yeah, this is this bit about dance dialogue between the melody and the accompaniment. And what I'm trying to say with that is the two things are equal. We sometimes have the idea that the melody should dominate and the accompaniment should support. And in this orchestra, I think we have this relationship a little bit like a leader and the follower, where you can't have it without both of them. And in some moments, one is more important, in other moments, the other is more important. And I think this sort of dynamic relationship also makes this music very exciting to dance to. The melody isn't the only story here. There's a very rich set of colors and textures and things to respond to that are answering the melody or that are supporting the melody. Good. And of course. That has to be Troilo, yes? It's this sort of take your breath away moment, yeah? Everything kind of drops out, and we hear something very delicate and very sort of soulful. And this is what I think is unique or special with this orchestra. Good. And there's Troilo with his pachuco. Well, now, Mr. Pugliesi also recorded this song. And this is a different world, as you might expect. It's also a different time frame. Yeah, he recorded this relatively late in his career. And I'm calling it an episodic adventure ride, yeah, because we never look back. Yeah, this is always something new coming, always something new coming. Even the melody gets a little bit lost in here. Yeah. It starts with this beautiful bandoneon solo. Mis Ojos Negros, I promise. It is, it's coming. It's almost there, it's almost there. Yeah, the melody comes eventually, and it's accompanied with this sort of driving ostinato. What's an ostinato? It drives? Okay, it's a repeated figure, yeah? Repeats over and over again, perhaps with different notes, yeah? And it's something a little bit unusual in tango, until you get to Piazzolla, yeah? This is not a typical way of accompanying a melody. And wow, it creates a very dramatic effect. We don't know if we're falling in love with the black eyes or if we're angry with them. It's all mixed up. It's the Jones remix, yeah. And here the form falls apart. So when I say the form falls apart, it means when we expect the next thing to happen metrically in the music, we're still on the last thing, yeah? He kind of freely says, oh, you know, I need another two bars here, guys. Can you hold on a second? I just want to milk this. I want to stretch it out and give even more, yeah? And this, again, makes this music special for us as dancers. Our intuition on when things start and stop doesn't work here, yeah? We have to kind of stay actual. We have to stay live with it. Our eight-bar patterns don't work here. Yeah, this asks for a different way of dancing. Good. This is totally invented. Has very little to do with the melody. Someday we'll come back to the melody. It's in there. It's just kind of hidden. Yeah, I'm going to cut it short for reasons of time. But this is, I think, very typical, especially of late Pugliesi, that we take an idea that people know and we kind of disguise it. We put on a totally different arrangement or outfit of it, and then it's somebody all new. Ojos Negros are suddenly, maybe it's Shakira, I don't know, but it's no longer this lovely lady. Good. I'm going to move on and give you a D'Arienzo version of the same song. Does anybody here play the D'Arienzo recording of Ojos Negros? I'm very happy to hear that. Good, good. It sounds like this. It's a late arrangement. It's arranged by Carlos Lacerdi, who was one of his bandoneon players. We know Carlos Lacerdi from Este es el Rey. Do you know this piece? It's like a overdone show tango. Yeah, yeah. This is his approach to Ojos Negros. So if you were preparing a tanda with Loca and Este es el Rey and maybe El Puntazo and you wanted something even more crazy, maybe you would go to this. But otherwise, it's hard to imagine. But he uses the same tricks that we get from Este es el Rey. This is nice sort of, musicians sometimes call it a canjengue rhythm, where the orchestra just goes crazy underneath. Recognize that? Yeah, this big dramatic pause in the middle. You ready? Here it comes. Good. That's enough of that. Yeah. I sorry to cut him off just before the big thing, but you get where he's going, right? Yeah. Good. So I'm going to skip over this next section. Yeah, we're really at the end, but the idea that I'll tell you in brief was to look at how these orchestras aged. And in general, it's not very pretty from my perspective as a dancer, but how it went from a time where the dancers were the dominant influence on the dance to a time where record sales were the dominant influence on the production of the music. But like I said, I'm going to spring over that and bring you guys to a nice soft landing with... Yes, a little quiz. Yes, so each of these orchestras recorded the song Quejas de Bandoneón. Do you recognize this name at least, if not the song? Yeah? So I'm going to play a little bit, and I'll let it play until you guys are sure which orchestra it is, okay? What are our four orchestras? De Sarli? Okay. Good. I hear it in different orders, but good. We've got them all. We've got D'Arienzo, we've got De Sarli, we've got Troilo, we've got Pugliese. Yeah? Which one is this? Any guesses? Survey says... Good. Number two. Here's some De Sarli. Are you guys happy with that answer? Okay. Well, we're narrowing it down now. Yeah, it's 50-50. You have a pretty good chance. Who's this one? Sounds a lot like De Sarli, though, doesn't it? But it's definitely not Pugliese, yeah? Yeah, we can know that it's Troilo by the ends of the phrases, and when the bandoneon solo comes in, then it's a different world. But the starting point's not so different from De Sarli. Well, then this last one's kind of a giveaway. Who could that be? No, I thought this one was so obvious that it would just be too easy if we knew it first. But I want to let you listen. How does he treat this melody? He's totally taking it apart, yeah? But he loves those bandoneons. There's the tune, yeah? Okay. I hope not. Maybe. No, I shouldn't say that. You know, I can imagine there's a time at like 5:30 in the morning, yeah? And we're all like dead tired and maybe drunk already and you know, the boys are dancing with the boys and the girls are pointing and laughing and then this comes on. Yeah, it could be. But no, this isn't from the dance repertory. And it's interesting that Pugliese, he made some interesting choices about what he recorded late in his career. But I think it was really this sort of adventure of how do we reconstruct or recreate or deconstruct these loved pieces. And part of the reason that it works is that these pieces are so well known by his audience. Yeah, that he can every once in a while make a little reference to it, and we get it. We say, oh yeah, that's Quejas de Bandoneón. And there are a lot of late Pugliese arrangements that are like this. We get lost in it a little bit unless we know the piece really well, and then we can pick out his references. Good. Let me make a quick sort of closure here, and then I would love to take some questions. But basically to say, this is incomplete. Yeah, to describe why these orchestras are important for us as dancers, I think would take many hours, maybe many weeks or many years. It would probably involve a lot of dancing, not a lot of sitting and listening. Yeah, and I encourage you to pursue that. I think there's a reason. It's not just an empty tradition, but there's a reason that these orchestras have persevered so long. There's a reason that they've created and sold so many recordings. There's a reason that they were so loved by people in their time and by DJs in later generations and by milongueros. Yeah, this music in its own way reaches to us as dancers. And then this is, I think, an interesting question to leave with. What does that mean, that the music reaches to us as dancers? What would it mean that an orchestra wants to make us dance in a certain version? And how do we answer that, that call or that invitation? So I want to leave that question dangling. And I want to thank Felipe and Ayano for inviting me to share this with you. Thank you. And if we have a minute or two, I'd love to take some questions. Yes. Oh, that's a good question. The question, why is the orchestra more recognized than the composer? It's almost always this way, and I think it's because the orchestra is on stage, and the orchestra is the one making the flyer, and the orchestra is the one who's selling it, yeah? The composer is somewhere in a back room. Yeah, this is different in popular music than it is in classical music. In classical music, it's the other way around. Yeah, we say, oh, that's Mozart. We don't say that's the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. Yeah, in tango music, I think we recognize the performer more than the composer. And maybe it's because many of these songs are performed by nearly every tango orchestra. Yeah, the pieces that I've chosen today were pieces that these four orchestras have made versions of or recordings of, but nearly every orchestra that has a large catalog has also recorded these songs. So then to say, okay, yeah, who was the composer of Comparsita? It becomes less important than which version of Comparsita are we drawn to as dancers. I see it something like that. Yeah. Yeah. No, I should. I do not have a YouTube channel yet, but there is a collection of about 10 years of these sorts of presentations, and it's slowly making its way to a website so creatively named tangomusicfordancers.com. Yeah, and I know it's terrible, right? If you have a better name, go to that site and suggest the name to me. And if you get to that site and you don't see very much there, drop me a message and give me a little poke and say, Korey, put your slides online. Yeah. I should. I have. I have a 14-month-old boy at home, and he's telling me the same thing, but he's also saying, yeah, but tomorrow, pay attention to me right now. So, yeah. Yes?
Yeah, you talk briefly about the role of the arrangers.
Yes.
Now, I would assume that there would be feedback between the orchestra and the arrangers. Can you comment?
I can give you little examples. Yes, the famous example is Troilo. Like I said, Troilo didn't do his own arranging for the most part, but he had very strong ideas about what the arrangement should be. And apparently, he sort of disassembled most of the arrangements that came to him and rebuilt them or had them rebuilt in his vision. I have a bunch of manuscripts from Troilo's orchestras, and you can see lots of things just sort of X'd out, or somebody scribbles, go to here, or do this way. I mean, it's heavily edited in pencil, I presume, yeah? And I think these things happened in the rehearsal process, and I imagine they happened under the guidance of Troilo. So, yeah, the arranger gives the starting point, and then he apparently, in the course of... well, there are also stories about him spending weeks on a new song, alone in a room with a singer, trying to figure out how to do the phrasing of it. So, I mean, he was very hands-on with the execution of it, just not necessarily with putting the notes on the page, yeah? Other questions? Yeah.
Stereotype and describe the
That's interesting. I'm out of my depth here, yeah. But I'll give a shot at it. Because I spend a lot of time, normally when I do these presentations, they're full of video examples, yeah? And I was trying to find a dance pair that I thought gave very representative performances that had performed to all of these orchestras. And that was nearly impossible, or at least to find somebody who I was inspired by, who had performed on YouTube to all four of these orchestras, which surprised me. And then what I would take from that is it's kind of a different sort of person who would do a lot of Troilo or D'Arienzo than the person who would do a lot of De Sarli and Pugliesi. And there's some crossover, but there's very little complete crossover. So Horacio Godoy, a very literal dancer, yeah? He's like a cartoon. If something's in the music, you see it in his body, yeah? And I thought, okay, this would be perfect. I can put on four videos of Horacio Godoy dancing to each of these orchestras. Which orchestra would you expect I couldn't find from Horacio Godoy? Yeah. Sort of this very elegant, genteel, subtle. Yeah. He's not interested. Yeah. Sorry? De Sarli. If somebody knows of a video of Horacio dancing De Sarli, let me know. I'll write him and ask him. Please. I was very surprised because this is, for me, one of the most important orchestras, and surely he had danced it in his long career, but at least it didn't end up on YouTube that I could find. And I searched. There's a tendency, I think, with younger dancers to go for energetic music, or there was, yeah, and then there's a sort of backlash. You look at, do you know Carlitos and Noelia, maybe? Yeah, okay, good. A young pair that dances close embrace in a beautiful, musical, and energetic way. And initially, they were performing a lot of D'Arienzo, a lot of Tanturi, a lot of sort of energetic rhythmic music. Troilo, you can also find. And then after a few years, and maybe having the feedback, yeah, but what else can you do? Then we have beautiful recordings of them dancing to Pugliesi. I don't know if I have a De Sarli of the two of them. I don't think so. What I do have with De Sarli is a lot of older generation dancers who have a more sort of refined or relaxed way of dancing, for whom the rhythmic basis isn't the most important thing in the dance. There's something more about Chicho, absolutely. That's a good question. I could imagine we could find all four from Chicho. He wasn't on my list of models because I think he has a very particular dance style. And I don't know, for me, sort of showing something to a group of social dancers, I don't know. I've used Chicho videos a lot for musicality classes because, again, he's somebody who shows very clearly the music. But he wasn't on my list for this presentation. Yeah. Yeah. I found lots of sort of crosses where I could get two or three orchestras. And in the D'Arienzo Pugliesi version, there's lots of videos because there's lots of people who cross over between these orchestras. And actually, there's lots of songs that cross over between these two orchestras. So you could find the same song danced differently by very good dancers. But yeah, to get all four was tricky. Yeah. Pick one. Fortunately, as a tango dancer that just likes to dance in the milonga, I don't have to pick one. And I think this is something, this for me is an important point. We're doing the show. We have to decide. Are we going to do Troilo's Que Hasta Bandoneon, or are we going to do, God forbid, Pugliesi's? Yeah? But in the milonga, we hear what the DJ provides for us. We have a wonderful DJ providing for us this afternoon. And Lampis gets to decide who my favorite orchestra is. Yeah? No, but it's an evasive answer. For me, it changes over time. And I think probably what I can say more clearly is that it depends on who I'm dancing with. So the orchestra comes on, and if it's Troilo and a favorite Troilo partner is available, that is suddenly my favorite orchestra. Yeah. If it's Troilo and I can't find a favorite Troilo partner, then maybe it's no longer my favorite orchestra because I'm kind of frustrated that my partner doesn't hear or respond to the music in the way that I like to hear and respond to the music. Yeah. So it's not an answer I can, as a solo person, I can't say that's my favorite orchestra because it depends. It depends on who I'm dancing with. It depends on the moment. That being said, as a DJ, I feel much more safe with D'Arienzo and De Sarli than I do with Troilo and Pugliesi. Yeah, there's sort of a risk factor, and it's like a spectrum, yeah? I feel like in nearly any milonga anywhere in the world, I can put on a good Darienzo Echagüe tanda, and the room will be happy, yeah? With the Sarli, I also feel that's pretty safe, yeah? Troilo, I'm sure there's a moment in the night, yeah, when that would make everybody in the room happy, but I don't think it's every moment. And then Pugliese, this for me is even more special, yeah? The right time and the right crowd for Pugliese is for me... it's a special moment, yeah? And I hope that every milonga has that moment, and I hope that every group has that thing. But for me, it's not as safe as putting on D'Arienzo or De Sarli. Yeah.
You mentioned D'Arienzo Echagüe. What role do you think a singer plays in characterizing the music?
Yeah, a big one, and it depends on the orchestra. I did a little bit of this. I did a class recently with D'Arienzo versus Pugliese, yeah, and they had a little boxing match, and we looked at the relationship of the singers within that that spectrum, and I would say, oh, this is hard to give a short answer to, but there's an influence in both directions. The singer influences the orchestra, and the orchestra influences the singer. And in an orchestra like Troilo, for example, I think he builds things around the singer. Yeah. So Troilo with Fiorentino is very different than Troilo with later singers. And you feel it as a dancer immediately. I'm not giving you a very satisfied answer to the question, because I think it's a question that needs a lot more time and thought for my part. But I would say we have to consider it almost a different orchestra. When the orchestra changes singers, yeah, and yeah, it's a relationship in two directions. Yeah. Good. I mean, this depends on whether I got my dancer hat on or my DJ hat on. Yeah. As a DJ, it's definitely not in the first 2 hours of the milonga. Yeah. For me, this comes later in the evening when people are kind of settled in and feeling good and warmed up and connected with the people around them. For me, it's a sort of heightened emotional level with this orchestra, even with the earlier recordings. Then I guess I'm looking for a moment where I feel like the room not only can take it, but is hungry for it, you know? I like to build pretty slowly. So if I had the idea, okay, this crowd is ready for Pugliese at midnight, then at about 10:45, I would start a kind of ramp up to Pugliese. And maybe we would go through some Tanturi Campos, yeah? And maybe we would hit Larenz with Podesta, and we'd be going a little more and a little more emotional until we finally get to the point in the cycle where we can just lay it all on the line with Pugliese, and hopefully the dancers are ready for it. I think every DJ has a different strategy around this, though, and I've had really good experience as a dancer with DJs who sort of trick me, you know? We have a little Canaro tanda, and I think, okay, we're in sort of sweet rhythmic land, and then the next tanda, Pugliese, yeah? And the contrast couldn't be bigger, and sometimes that works too. So it's a question of strategy. But I like this sort of long build. Good. I imagine that you're all actually quite interested in starting the milonga. And so once again, I want to thank you for coming out on a Saturday morning and listening to something about tango music. And yeah, enjoy your weekend.
Thank you very much, Corey. Of course, it's always a pleasure to have you with us. And it's an invaluable information. He also went through an ordeal to come here from Germany. You guys don't need to know that part, but we almost had to cancel the lecture. So we really are happy that he was here. And I also want to thank Ben and Pierre and John and Peter for putting the production to videotape the whole thing. Hopefully we'll be able to.